Hey everyone, how's it going? This is your host Yoshino, and you're listening to episode number 67 of Artists Decoded. In this episode, I get the opportunity to talk to Joshua Hagler, Maja Ruznic, and Jarell Perry at our live event for No Wave called Mind Wave. And I'm here right now with Justin Hopkins. How's it going?
How are you? Hey man, I'm good. How are you doing?
Good. How'd you like the event?
I loved it, man. It was a good time. I thought it was great having all those minds under one roof, you know. And I think everybody who came out was enlightened by it, or at least entertained by it. Like we kind of like
enlightenedly entertained.
Yeah. Well, we ran the gamut of pure like information and philosophical banter into like just like the wildness of Michael Donovan. So I think it was pretty good.
Yeah, the wildness of Michael Donovan and Noah Lampert.
Yeah, we had a wide spectrum of different ways to interact with these people. So I think a lot of people enjoyed it.
Yeah. What'd you think about the Daniele Buelli, Zach Leary, Corey Allen, and Third Eye Drops conversation?
It was great. I mean, I always liked Daniele Buelli's philosophies a lot, and I like his analogies and his stance on strategic philosophy and like fighting, and I like his
I really relate to that too.
Yeah, well, just the way he like can bring it in, bring like something that's pretty unapproachable, like you know, metaphysical philosophy or whatever it is he talks about, into a way that like everybody can at least understand.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. I appreciate that about him a lot.
Definitely. Yeah, and just to let everyone know, we're recording from the No Wave space here in Los Angeles. Just give you a little bit of context of where we are right now. If you hear a little bit of cavernous echoing, it's because this is a giant space, and this is like our pseudo recording area right now. And we actually have Mind Wave 2 already in the works, so we'll let everyone know about that. And if you'd like to be put on our guest list for No Wave, feel free to email me at info@artistdecoded.com. We also have a workshop coming up with Emilio Villalba and Blake Newpert. It's on Saturday, March 25th, over here at the No Wave space in Los Angeles. If you want more information on that, please email me at info@artistdecoded.com. All right, well, here it is, episode number 67 of Artists Decoded. This is a live podcast taking place at the No Wave space in Los Angeles. Hope you like it.
Oh, no. Do a little bit better than that.
Cool. So I'm Yoshino. I run a podcast called Artists Decoded. It is a podcast about breaking down spirituality and art and combining the two, and also taking the structure and the process of being an artist and explaining it in some ways through interviews and through monologues and things like that. So I'm Yoshino, and this is Jarell. Jarell, if you want to introduce yourself.
Some intros. Hi, my name is Jarell Perry. I'm a singer-songwriter based here in Los Angeles. Yoshino and I have been friends for the past couple years, worked on a couple creative projects together. I also run a self-development blog called Still Mind, stillmind.co. It's focused on creating a culture of empathy and mindful awareness among artists and creative entrepreneurs.
Nice. Okay, my name is Maja Ruznic. I'm an artist, primarily a painter, but I do performances sometimes as well. And Josh and I we're together, I guess. and we met Yoshino exactly about a year ago. Actually, Facebook told me, like, a year ago, you did the Artist Decoded.
What, a year ago today?
It was actually March 14th, so not exactly, but...
almost,
yeah. So, yeah, we did an interview with Yoshino about a year ago, and then, yeah.
Yeah, I'm Joshua Hagler, also a painter, as Maja was just discussing, and we've done a few things together, too. We've been doing this together for 4 years, I guess. And we traveled and did a book together called Drift, where we went through Jordan and visited refugee camps there and went through different parts of Europe and worked on this book together. So aside from making the art, also I write a column called How to Give a Shit for Venison Magazine, which is an online art magazine regional to the West Coast. And I guess that's about it.
Yeah. So I guess if everyone, I did want to put you guys' Instagram handles out there if anyone wanted to check out their work, because this panel is mostly directed towards you two and your work. Well, not mostly, but you know.
Yeah, we planned on having images of our work, but it's not dark enough. So if you guys, as we're speaking about our work, if you want to have some visuals, if you go on Instagram, mine is my handle is MAJARUZ, Maja Ruz, and then what yours is?
Hagler Josh.
So if you want some visuals while we're speaking, go on there. Yeah.
Very good.
And I just wanted to say again how encouraged I am for this is the first event. Still Mind is actually co-hosting this event with MindPod Network and No Wave and Artist Decoded, and for this to be the first event where we could really experience you guys live and have these conversations just really open and free form about art and creativity and mindfulness, I think is really special. I think we all spend a lot of time in front of screens and like literally liking the hell out of everything, you know, like, but it's cool to actually bring that process into like a real life human experience. You know, a lot of people I'm meeting for the first time in person, so it's great. So
I guess, so we can begin, I guess if you want, Maja and Josh, if you want to explain some of your artistic process and, you know, what it means to you or how that relates to spirituality in a sense.
Just get in there, you're saying.
Yeah, just get right in there. Yeah.
Do you feel ready? Do you want to start? Or?
Sure.
Okay, go for it. Okay. I'll think about it for a while.
Okay. Well, I'm mainly a painter, and sometimes I'll work in other media as well. So that could range from installation to video, animation, altered books, things like that. A lot of my work, pretty much all of it, is pretty research-based, where I'll actually do like research trips or something like that. Recently, I was following the Missouri River for a few different reasons. I was looking at like layered history, and I like to look at sites where maybe I can see evidence of many moments in history sort of existing at different times, and then I'll make work that can somehow bring these together in what maybe seems unnatural, but somehow there's some kind of intuitive drive to sort of show those things existing at once. So I'm really interested in time itself. And depending on the type of work that I'm doing, sometimes I might bring, say, like the language of physics into it, where I might find some kind of metaphorical or poetic potential in theoretical physics, say. Historically, I've been very interested in the history of religion. Partly the reason why I followed the Missouri River was because of following parts of famous trails. It'd be part of westward expansion, which there's a religious subtext in that as well. So I'm looking at the problematics, but I'm also trying to extricate a kind of poetry from that as well. So I think of the work is grounded in research, but really the motivation behind that is something that I would describe as spiritual.
Did you go to school for that? Or?
No, I didn't go to art school per se, but I went to the University of Arizona where I got a degree in basically graphic design.
Okay. I was wondering if the role that your research in religion and geography, topography, if that was any formal education or that's just nerding out?
Well, it's that I grew up in a very religious environment, and when I got older, I moved away from that community, and I became very interested in understanding that better after the point that I left.
What sort of religious environment?
Well, I mean, they were different depending on, I moved around the country a lot, so I feel like a lot of times people I have a hard time describing it because I don't like want to like sort of like call something out of like, oh, the Calvary Chapel or something. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
it wasn't. It was really different depending on where I was, but I was heavily involved in like campus Christian organizations and things like that, and I would get into a lot of trouble when I was in school because I also had a daily comic strip and I would say things that they didn't like, and then, you know, that wasn't edifying to the Lord, so then I kind of got a talking to, and I, you know.
Wait, is this
I,
like high school or?
This is college. I mean, like, I was kind of a late bloomer, certain ways.
No, that's, I mean, I resonate with that because I grew up in a pretty, I grew up Baptist, actually, and then I went to Christian school for the first half of my childhood before I went to high school. And
oh, okay.
It's like definitely on the Jesus train. And, I don't know. I never really got, I didn't have a comic strip, so that's not nearly as cool as you.
You maybe got in trouble for other things, though. I don't know. I'm sure you found some trouble to get into.
We won't talk about it. No, but yeah. So when did you find yourself like breaking away from that? Because I feel like in my early 20s, and like you mentioned like being a late bloomer, and like I feel like I never went through a rebellious phase as a kid, you know, like most people have this like adolescent angst, you know, and I kind of went in the opposite direction and wanted to be like super pious and like super, devoted. And then, so I didn't really get to experience that until like my early to mid 20s. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, same, basically. I mean, I wouldn't have described myself ever as pious. It was this kind of wonderful paradox where I felt like obligated to sort of believe certain things or agree with certain things, but then also I would get kicked out of Sunday school sometimes, mm-hmm. just for like, you know, being a little rambunctious.
Yeah,
but my, you know, I was still very like tethered to it.
What do you think made you want to be rebellious, or rather, what do you think made you want to talk about religion within the work that you do?
I think at the time, I mean, I was making work for a few years. I didn't know what it was, why. I just didn't know what my work was. And I think at a certain point, living in San Francisco for a few years, and I, among the people that I hung out with or talked to, other artists or whatever, that actually I found my experiences were more unique than I would have thought before moving. Because where I grew up, everyone had that experience, basically. So I felt kind of like uniquely position to regard it in some way. And I think because it was so personal, it was just kind of what I had to talk about in the work. So those initial paintings that I first started making, that, you know, I started showing and getting more attention for, were really just very simply looking at like church congregations and making paintings of those and trying to carry some of its emotional or psychological weight.
Do you think there's like a message behind it? Are you looking for the audience to interpret your paintings in a certain way, or was it like an intention behind, or like a deeper meaning behind showing the congregations and those kind of things?
To tell the truth, I think at the time I was really angry.
Yeah,
I was still angry. So there was. It was catharsis. I mean, you know, I still like some of that work, but sometimes it was a little melodramatic, I think. Yeah.
So Maja, do you have did you have like a similar experience? And
no. Very different. Yeah. I guess to me it makes most sense to talk about from when I was a kid. Rather than, because I didn't grow up thinking I would be an artist. It was not until after college, actually. So it's not like something, you know, I feel like most artists say, you know, I've known I was an artist my whole life. And I grew up in Bosnia, with my mom and her parents. So I was raised by my mom and my grandma and grandpa. And my grandma was very religious. She is Muslim. My mom, however, was, she was kind of, the rebel in the family. So she did not want me to grow up Muslim. She was, I don't think at the time she called herself an atheist. I think she's more of a, she's very spiritual, but she didn't want me going to the equivalent of Sunday school, whereas my grandma really encouraged it. And I think that's my earliest and only memory I have of ever going to something organized. And before we moved to the U.S., I had a different last name. It was actually my biological father's name, which is Serbian. My biological father was a Christian Orthodox. And Maja is not a Muslim name. So I remember my first day at this like mosque school, all the other kids were named like Azmira and Ahmed and Muhammad. And then there's like Maja. So I felt like I stuck out. And it didn't feel right. And I think that visceral bodily feeling of being in this organized place is something I still have in how I make decisions in life. Like it just either feels right or it doesn't. So that was the first and only time I went, and I came back and I told my grandma. I remember looking at her, I'm like, not going back to that place. Wow.
So how old were you?
I was like 6 or 7. Oh, okay. I was really young. We left Bosnia when I was 8 or 9. But I remember being into mythology. My mom would go to Greece a lot, and she would come back and bring back books about Greek mythology, and I loved Medusa. And we would watch like David Lynch films. My mom was not like, this is not for children, you know? So I would be sitting there watching.
Which ones? Which films?
You know, we were obsessed with Twin Peaks. So my mom and I, little 8-year-old Maja, would like sit next to her weird mother and we would watch Twin Peaks. And I was in love with the music and the darkness. And I think that's something I got from my mom, like this complete acceptance of the shadow side. Not so much where I want to be there, but I was never afraid of things that are maybe scary or I think things that people want to kind of stay away from. Right. If anything, I just wanted to go there and see what's there, what's in the cave.
Hmm. Yeah, you were curious about it.
I was very curious. I mean, I liked all the creatures in mythology. And, you know, my grandma would tell me if I was a bad kid, I would get, you know, Baba Yaga would come and get me. Baba Yaga or Babaroga in Slavic mythology was this old woman who lived in the forest and in a house with chicken legs. I'm like, that's cool. I want to be, I'm like, I want her to catch me, wow. You know? So there's this, it didn't really work like these little, like, don't do that. Didn't really get. The fear actually became an activator for me.
Wow.
For curiosity.
Why do you think you're drawn to that, though? Have you thought about that at all?
Yeah, I have, because people often look at my work and they say it's dark and it's spooky, you know, my least favorite word. I'm like, can you come up with a better word? You know, spooky is kind of like...
it's a kind of like a cop-out.
Yeah, it's like I would rather them tell me it makes me feel anxious. Because then I would say, okay, I'm doing a good job here. But spooky, it's like, is it spooky like a David Lynch film? Because that's good. Or is it spooky like a cheesy horror movie?
It sounds like, you know, a little reductive.
Reductive, yeah. Yes. Yeah. I think I'm drawn to it because I think it's titillating to the body. There's something really like that kind of wakes you up. I think for the same reason that we like to get on scary rides, yeah. You know, where it's like we feel awake. And I think there's something about on the edge of afraid and not totally afraid that I think something opens up.
Yeah.
And for me, that's not too different from spirituality.
Totally. That's awesome.
Or how I think of it, at least.
Yeah.
No, I was just asking because ever since I was a kid, I've always really been into horror movies and gore and things like that. And maybe it just comes from like a primal instinct. Or some sort of like curiosity towards those things, but I don't know what it is. Some people don't, or it's not something that is of interest to some people, you know, but to other people it may be like me, I guess, but I don't know why.
Well, I don't know if you had it. I'm curious, but my mom, she was my primary guardian. I didn't have a father figure growing up, and she was very permissive. You know, so I didn't really grow up with a sense of right and wrong. And I wouldn't say that she raised an immoral child. But, you know, like these like religious thoughts that we have of like, that's a good thing to do. This is a bad thing to do. Do a nice thing for your neighbor. And it's almost like you're accruing good credit for something. Like that was not part of my upbringing. It's just like, you just are.
That's interesting.
And,
yeah.
And I think having permission to explore areas that are dark, made me enjoy them. You know, I know sometimes people, when they're oppressed and you tell them, don't go there, they want to go there. But for me, it was actually about my mom kind of opening it all up for me. And
yeah, I see what you mean.
You know?
Yeah.
So did you have a similar, I don't know, were you, or...
When I was growing up, I went from first grade till about high school to Christian school, and I only went to my freshman year of high school. I went to a public school, which was totally just like culture shock to me at that particular time. But so I've always had this sort of like instilled morals, you know, like very strict instilled morals within me. Whether that's a good or bad thing, I mean, that's just how I grew up.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I was never monitored for like films I would watch. So at a very young age, I would watch some pretty graphic, films. You know, whether that be like Clockwork Orange or like some Stanley Kubrick film.
Yeah, we watched those like too, 11, my mom and I.
Yeah, like I was like 11 years old watching these films, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that really shaped the way that I am creatively in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
But I think maybe because like I was grounded in a sense of moral, I had like a relatively solid moral compass that it didn't deter me from being, a bad person. I mean, so
right.
I don't know, but it's interesting that to think about how things connect from like the childhood to now, and how it relates to the way that you structure your thoughts and how you have conversations with people and things like that. Because, and that's also why, like in podcasts, I generally ask people about their childhood, because, it psychologically kind of, in either negative or positive ways, will determine how you are and how you think and how you structure yourself.
Yeah. Often when I'm painting and I'm using a color, like it happened like a month or so ago, I was using this magenta that had a dark purple underneath. And as I was like applying it on like an area that was about this big, I just had this memory of my mom buying a sweater for me that was that exact color that I loved wearing because it was super soft and it was a reversible sweater. So all of a sudden I was like transported into that time.
Yeah.
And then the painting became about my mom. And I didn't even know that that's what I was working on until that color activated some memory that then guided me to finish the painting.
Wow.
So,
you know how you're always saying that the paintings are better than you are? You know, I think like when we're talking about the way that like maybe these early ways in which we grow up, you know, be it like the religious background that we have or just the cultural background in general, there's a way in which like you see that manifested in the work. So one big difference between us is like the way in which how you're describing that color comes out. It reminds you of a sweater, it reminds you of your mother, and before you know it, this thing is revealed to you, you know? Whereas I have a much more ordered way of thinking and making work and everything.
Right.
And I feel like if we were to talk about what we were taught when we were growing up, it just makes so much sense that
totally.
We would approach things in the way that we do. And you guys probably find the same in your work.
But do you think that makes you maybe more, that makes you respect each other even more because you come at art, it kind of like, in different approaches, you know, like you're saying, you're more structured, Josh, and Maja, it seems like you're more in touch with like the feeling. And maybe if you, you know, throw some paint onto a canvas and then you just let it like fall, and then you can, it kind of like construct something around that, you know?
We definitely, I would say we respect it, and we also create our structures differently. For example, if you walk into our studios, Josh's studio is really messy. But my studio, it's like, I need to like,
call
sorry.
Out.
Yeah, I know, calling you out. Sorry, I didn't mean it in like,
no,
you know, but it's like,
okay. Yeah,
and
it's
then
messy.
Mine, it's like, I like to sweep first. It's like this whole thing I need to like of sweeping, and then I need to like clean my palette, and then I have to squeeze the colors. They have to glisten in a certain way. It's like, it's a little OCD.
Yeah.
And then but when I start, it's all improvisation. Mm-hmm. But like the structure, and I think you can maybe say a bit about how you start.
I mean, that improvisation to me, like the way you go straight in is like, I love it because it seems to me like a type of magic almost, you know, and I wouldn't know how to do it, you know? So it's just very, it feels really important sometimes when I see something like really turn out mm-hmm. in the studio, where I'm like, wow, how did you get there? You know? It's like, conversely, I feel like I have to gather so many resources and materials or whatever to sort of create this armature where at least it gets going somewhere. And then I create these obstructions because I tend to want too much control. And when I introduce those obstructions, that's where the improvisation takes place. And that's where my favorite part of the work happens. But yeah. I have to sort of trick myself into letting go.
Yeah, I feel like that's more of my process too. Like in songwriting, it was a lot worse when I was starting out, but I was like very heady and like I would be like basically like Wikipediaing like lyrics, like lyrical ideas, wow. and like diving deep like in research, and like, because that's how I grew up, was just like, okay, straight A's, like always studying, like A plus B equals C, and this is how you do it. So that was the approach that I brought to my art. But now,
probably felt safe to have like a method.
It felt safe, yeah. And also it's like this whole need for control, which is something that over time I've learned to unwrap that and like learn how to put more feeling into mm-hmm. it and more intuition. But I also think intuition is something that you have to develop, and you have to develop it almost like outside of your process, like go live your life, like go have a relationship, like go do this and that, and then you are able to bring that back to your process.
Mm-hmm. Where do you think your intuition comes from?
That's a good question.
That's a really good question.
I don't really see it as something coming from somewhere. I feel like it's something that just is, and that you are, and that you're kind of just like scrubbing it away to see what it is. If you get what I'm saying, like, yeah. I don't think it's like, it's not like inspiration. Like I got a stroke of inspiration, or like there was a muse and this happened. I feel like just based on my experiences, I think intuition is really like a combination of like my experiences and my intention in interpreting those experiences, and my willingness to like learn lessons and grow from that, you know? And through those processes, it's kind of like getting an ear, you know? And I feel like intuition is really the ear that I'm using to like hear what's my next move, you know? Yeah. And then the next thing is to listen to it. Like listen and follow your intuition, because it's one thing to feel it and to hear it, and another to follow.
To follow it, yeah.
Did you ever have to get to a point where you had to learn to trust it better? Like you always maybe had it, but there was something that was getting in the way of trusting.
Yeah, I think it was a lot of the way that I was raised and the way, and I don't want to like blame everything on my childhood. My mom's probably watching the live stream or something, like, crying. No, no, I think it was, it's me kind of letting go of that control, or the need for evidence all the time, like empirical evidence, like this works, you know? Cause sometimes you don't know if it works or not. You just have to feel it.
It's almost like a force that has its own mind that you just kind of have to like surrender to. And it kind of, if you let it drive.
Right. And just being okay with the unknown. You know, I think that was a huge part of my growth in the last couple of years, is just being okay not knowing what it's going to look like and not knowing what my next step is. But if I feel like I need to just take this step, then I'm going to take it anyways. Yeah.
Well, I can relate to this thing of where you're like being okay with not knowing what it looks like.
Right.
I realized that that's actually the only thing I'm comfortable with when I'm making a painting. So when I start, I'll make a couple marks and I have a few colors, and then I'll flip the painting around completely just so I get this like rush in my stomach, like almost like when you're in a roller coaster. And I became like, I feel like I'm a junkie for those rushes. Wow. And I realize when I don't flip the painting, so if it's like I know that the feet are on the bottom and the head is at the top, and it's been a few days and I'm working in that orientation, I get very bored. So it's for me, actually knowing what it will be is the thing I'm most afraid of. Wow. But like being completely surprised is like like the thing I'm constantly chasing.
Is it like the sense of like wanting some kind of a revelation in the process? I mean, is that what drives maybe even the interest in making a painting in the first place?
Yeah, I think it's like I want to not, you know, Annie Lapin, another really amazing LA painter. I read in an interview, she said, "I want to make something, and at the end, I don't even want to know what it is that I'm looking at." And I read that, and I have that article in my studio, and I look at it all the time. Like, that's it. And I think the reason why that really resonated for me is because I don't want to make a picture that reminds me of other pictures I've seen. It's like I want to make something that's like a portal where I don't even know what it is, but like my senses are really awake. And like that's the only reason why, that's the only way it feels worth the time when I'm completely surprised with.
All my favorite parts of my own paintings are all the things that I didn't account for, I didn't know about beforehand, and I couldn't describe. Maybe I wasn't even comfortable with at first, and you leave it for a couple of days and you come back and you look at it, and then you can only really see it the right way after it's been a few days. But getting comfortable with the unknown, and then it's like probably our greatest ally as artists is the unknown itself. It's like if we're just dwelling with what we already know, I don't think we can really get anywhere new, you know.
That kind of brings me to a question I had for you guys. Like, can you relate to the sense of the unknown? And do you think you can get it in other aspects of your life other than when you're making art, whatever that is for you, music, for you? Well, you're a maven. You're doing all kinds of things.
I think I've always liked to explore the unknown. I think that's kind of like a big driving force for me. I mean, even with like boxing and doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for so long, it was a way for me to challenge myself, you know, and because I never grew up, I guess I never grew up being like the tough guy, you know what I mean? So for me, in order for me to kind of like change my chemistry and psychologically too, I put myself in those situations to like learn, you know? Mm-hmm. And also, I mean, I think I've always been a person to trust my instincts and, but, you know, as you get older and you start understanding, trying to understand like how to make money from things that you do creatively, then it kind of switches your perspective on how to approach those things, right? But I think I've always been very instinctual and trying to trust my instinct. And I mean, even this, you know, it's like doing something like this, I mean, I've never really done an event that's, you know, that talks about art and spirituality necessarily, but it is parlayed from like the podcast in a sense. So I think there's baby steps to these things and it's like little experiments, but then, you know, I think as long as it feels right, then you should continue to do it. And once it feels wrong, then maybe rethink it and adjust. Mm. So the unknown has always been of interest to me. Yeah, I get excited for it.
I think the unknown, that whole, it's just a given part of the human process and the human condition, and it's just kind of how you choose to experience it. And I think I used to resist it a lot because I was just really obsessed with answers and always knowing the right answer.
Well, you know, it strikes me as like maybe all resisting the unknown is really just not admitting that you actually don't know. That right. Basically it's all unknown.
Yeah.
You know, because really like if you meditate on any kind of word, just take a single word or a question or whatever, like the more you think about it, the more of a stranger it becomes. It goes further and further from feeling like a thing. I don't know if I'm sounding crazy right now, if this is true for other people too, but...
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, I mean, it's... I mean, you know, like this most fundamental question of physics, like, why is there something rather than nothing? I mean, like, nobody can answer that. Like, that... I mean, that's a really basic question. So everything from there is pretty
it's
unknown.
Like, are there ever any conclusions? Like, do we ever come to a conclusion on what something is? You know, like... what art is, like what our art is, who we are. I don't know. I don't know if we ever come to the conclusion, you know, or maybe we do. I don't know.
I think we want to resist conclusion. I heard this Deleuze, this the philosopher Deleuze was talking about. I saw this video and he didn't really provide an explanation, so I don't know quite what his logic was in getting there. But you know, people, like we commonly say, oh, like art is to communicate. And he was, I saw him, he's like this video from the 50s and he's kind of like grumpy about it. He's like, art is not to communicate, it's to resist. You know, he's very insistent about this. And the more that I thought about that and the more that I looked about, you know, what worked for me best in my own work and looking around at other work, it was like sort of this blessing that it resisted. That if it were to communicate, that it would fall apart because whatever claim it wants to make will only work insofar as it keeps certain things out of frame. But as soon as you introduce those other problems into the frame, then the whole communicative part of it actually falls apart. It's like if it can resist that, then you have some kind of...
Yeah, like if you're trying to say like a particular thing, you lose that exploratory conversation with yourself.
Yeah, I mean, it probably in the end becomes some kind of unwitting propaganda. I mean, you don't know that it's propaganda when you're making it, but ultimately it fits into some kind of thought process that, you know, and it's not necessarily a bad thing, but it's hard to like, it's really hard to resist.
You know? Well, to me, it sounds like, as you guys are talking, I just keep hearing this like phrase or this word, it's like nonverbal, the spiritual is the nonverbal. You know, and I think mm-hmm. actually that's the unknown. That's also the sublime, what they called it. Like, and I think as human beings, you know, one of the first things when we're toddlers, we're like, we want to talk. Like there's this desire to communicate. And I'm reading this book by Ann Carson called Float. It's actually a chapbook and there's all these small little sections. And she's using language in a way that's completely dismantling as she's constructing something. And, I was also reminded of this experience where, as you guys were talking, I was like, what was your most perfect moment, Maja? And then I had this like memory of being in a sandbox when I was like 7 and it was like really hot and I could feel the sand on my thighs, like in the back, like kind of slightly burning it, and it felt perfect. And all the kids were playing in the playground and it was like the moment I realized I was a little weird, but also like how like this is it. And I know you've heard me say this many times, but it's like, it was it. And I didn't even know what the it was. But like, I had this like little, like something told me, it's like, this is what it is. And I think I'm trying to seek that through making art, like, this is it.
This is it being like a feeling or a knowing or...
For me, you know, I don't practice meditation. I'm not a Buddhist. But it felt like enlightenment for how I know it. It was like I was a little girl and like something told me that like I'm perfect. The world is perfect. Things are just the way they are. And this, it's like the isness. You just said, you know, intuition, mm-hmm. it's like the is.
Right.
And it was like the is.
And there in the sandbox.
Yes. Awesome. It was just there. And I haven't really felt that way since. I think I felt it one time when I was racing. I used to be a runner in college and I was in a race where I just felt like I didn't even run. Like, and I ran the mile and I ran 40 seconds faster than I had ever before. And I really felt like God came inside my body, and I'm not religious. And like, I don't even remember the other runners and everything was golden. And like, I won. And like, they were like, Maja, you know, runs 40 yeah. seconds faster than she ever has before. So I think that was the closest thing to the sandbox. Those only two memories.
Wow. I feel like I've had a sandbox moment.
Sandbox moment.
It wasn't the sandbox, but the feeling of that. I used to live by the beach over in Torrance in that area. I used to go to the beach about once a week, and I would just, there would be no one there because it's in the middle of the week, and I would just go to the, you know, out from the shore into the ocean, and I would just let the waves hit me. And I just remember that feeling and just being so grateful just to be there and do that, you know? And
that's a good word, grateful. Like there's a lot of like gratitude when it's happening.
Yeah.
The is happening.
Yeah. It's like, I don't really, I don't think you need like a lot of materialistic possessions necessarily to be happy. And I know that sounds like a cliche, but there's just, I mean, like last year I traveled a lot and I saw a lot of different places, and just understanding like in a third world perspective, you know, going to like Vietnam or going to Laos and seeing, you know, how little people live off of, you just realize that you're super, super lucky just to be in a country that you can actually express these thoughts freely. Mm-hmm. You can, you know, have a roof over your head and go to the beach and let the waves hit you.
Yeah.
You know, totally. And simplicity, there's some happiness in that simplicity mm-hmm. of thought.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I think for me, it's more, I think I have less of an experience of the isness as like this one big moment. Mm-hmm. And I'm starting to learn how to find it in like little moments. Mm-hmm. And it's also an intuitive thing. Like I could be like, I live like a mile away from here and I'm always walking down the street, but I could like stop on this corner and just something will, like the breeze will hit me in a certain way, right? And I'll intuitively know, like, this is a moment I should take, you know, mm-hmm. even if it's like 2 seconds, and just be grateful, you know, mm-hmm. even if the rest of the day was super shitty, you know.
Do you think you did something to open yourself up to recognizing, or how do you think, because I think we all feel the breeze or yeah. whatever it is, but it, like the moment you're like, the chatter stops and you're like, it's happening.
Yeah, I think, well, I do have a meditation practice that's okay. like a little bit off and on, but and also in different contexts. Like I do like daily meditations in the morning. Sometimes they're guided, sometimes they're not. And then I started doing this sensory deprivation floating mm-hmm. stuff.
Your brother's
own. Anybody yeah. heard of that? So I do that like once a month. Oh. And that's like 2 hours. It's a very rare experience, like to feel like you're back in the womb, if you could remember what that was, in a dark room. And mm. it's like, for people who don't know, you're just floating in a room in salt water. And yeah, there's just, you know, no phones, no anything.
So I have a question, I guess, yeah. for all three of you as you're talking about these perfect moments.
Yeah.
I think that I've had a few myself that I think of it. Well, I could get into that. But actually, the question is, even though I've had a handful of those, I've never known how to work with that in my art because they don't feel like they need me.
What do you mean they don't
well,
feel
the,
like
I mean, need? Okay, so when I was following the Snake River, I told you about that day where I was walking through a farmer's field and I walked almost into the crack in the ground before I realized that there was a canyon there. It was stunning. I mean, I didn't nearly fall off or anything, but I was pretty close before I realized that I knew that I was close to the river, but I didn't understand that what I was walking up to was a canyon. So when I got to the edge and I'm looking, I mean, that was a very perfect moment for me, you know, like mm-hmm. there is, no, I mean, I guess you feel like your ego drop away or something like that. I definitely had a sense of letting go. You know, I think we've all had moments like, hopefully mm-hmm. we have them fairly often if we're lucky. But that, like, I didn't go home and make a painting of the canyon. You know what I'm saying? Like that, I mean, it didn't need me. It was already like what was already was perfect. So I'm always like, in my work, I really gravitate toward tension, because I feel like if I look at something where, especially if it implicates like me, or if I think about the way that it implicates like my lineage or something like that, I take it and I want to transform it in some way and give it a different life, because the one that I'm encountering, I feel like has some need for some kind of transcendent or redemptive life. And so I know what to do with that, but I don't know how to use, what I'm thinking is, if I knew how to use those kinds of moments better in my work, I would have a better life balance.
Well, as so you said,
I was wondering if how you guys use them, if you can use those moments, how it.
I don't think of the isness for me, you call it the perfect moment or whatever. It's not something you use. It's not something you feel and then you try to replicate. It's about showing up, picking up the brush, having tension, and being lucky to feel the isness come through you that day. You sometimes don't ever get it. You sometimes have a month. So it's more of it's something that happens through the process. It's not something you try to create.
Yeah, I feel like it's more like whatever those moments are, they're moments that I suck in like a sponge, and then like later on, I would hope that I would let those things like come out, like seep back out in new ways. You know, as, like I said, just bringing that feeling into the process, but after it's kind of been processed or digested.
I feel like a certain amount of action needs to happen in order for that kind of flow to be possible.
Yeah, you have to show up. Like
you just have to sit there sometimes and like be patient if it never arrives, you know, and then show up anyways the next day.
That's the hardest part for me.
There's this quote by Kafka that I think about often that describes maybe what you guys are describing and something that sometimes the work itself will produce. And I'm going to mess up the quote, but I'm going to get the gist of it. And maybe when I mess it up, somebody out there will know what I messed up and they can say it correctly. I don't know. But so there's this, he says, sit still at your table and listen. Do not even sit, just wait. Do not even, it's like three layers, hold on. Do not even listen, just wait. In ecstasy, the world, the universe, oh man, how did it go? Oh, I've totally messed it up now. In ecstasy, the world will writhe at your feet, is basically how the quote ends. And the idea, I suppose, is like kind of getting to that kind of like quality of the sandbox, for instance. Mm-hmm. But sometimes when I'm like making the work, I can get to a stage where like something feels revealed, and then it feels like the world is in ecstasy, writhing at my feet.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
You know, I kind of feel it. It's, you know, we read this article a while ago in Hyperallergic about all these like young, they call them, they basically, in the author of this article, they grouped a certain kind of painter into the like art category, which is basically bright figurative painting that's like super hot right now. But they were, in the article, he was showing all these older dead artists who these newer artists were trying to emulate so much that it sometimes looked exactly alike. And I didn't even notice, you know, there was like a Georgia O'Keeffe kind of wannabe. And I think what maybe the author of that article was calling to is like there's this desire to like do the outline of the spirit that the original artist brought into the work. So I don't know. I feel like I kind of went off tangent. I don't even know why that was in relation to what you said. But I guess you can't tell someone how to get to their own sense of perfect moment. And I think everyone's flavor is different. Maybe that's what I mean. So I think maybe what's lost when younger artists or try to too much emulate the older artists is that they're not tapping into their own very unique, much more powerful sense of like perfect moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's the recognition of that isness or that oneness where you can really find yourself or start to find yourself, recognizing that you are yourself, and you don't have to be anyone else, and you don't have to, you're perfect as you are.
I actually find that's like the biggest challenge of teaching is trying to get students to value what comes naturally to them, because we're so used to seeing the way that like art is supposed to be. We think we've seen a certain number of things, especially students who are younger, who don't have that much experience yet, then they've got probably a fairly narrow idea about what art is supposed to be. And as you see more, maybe it grows. But to get to the point where you just can't help but let live that thing that comes naturally, I find is like a very rare quality in artists, but also, I mean, in students, to like to find a way to nurture that, to get them to trust something that doesn't look like how they think art is supposed to look. I just think that's like a lifelong challenge in many ways for so many of us.
Yeah. To me, that doesn't sound very different. Like when you're in high school and you go there and like everyone's dressed the same way, there's almost like this uniform, you know? So, and it's so hard to like have your own outfit and be weird. You know, there's like a couple of those kids. And I think it's not different in art sometimes or any other field that you're in. It takes a lot of fearlessness to just like dress weird and not worry if nobody asks you out on a prom date. You know, that's, you need to be brave to do that. It's 15.
Because then, well, then it's also, it's not just a prom date. It's like, it could be your paycheck, you know?
Right.
Or it could be, and a lot more at stake, like your self-worth, which is a whole other conversation.
Right.
But, yeah, I agree.
Cool. Should we end it there?
Sounds good to me. Feels natural. Yeah.
I just remember someone was saying 10 minutes. Is that...
Are we done?
Yeah. Cool. Thank you guys for listening.
All right, cool.
Thank you.